You are listening to a free version of Majority Report with Sam Steeder. To support this show and get another 15 minutes of daily program, go to majority.fm, please.
Children International is working to end child poverty around the world by giving kids access to a safe place, a team, and a path out of poverty by focusing on health, education, empowerment, and unemployment. Together with people like you, we're more than a nonprofit. We're a powerful force for change. Learn more at children.org.
The Majority Report with Sam Steeder.
It is Tuesday, November 19th, 2016. In this age of pre-dystopia, my name is Sam Steeder. This is the four-time award-winning Majority Report. We are broadcasting live. Steps from the industrially ravaged Gowanus Canal in the heartland of America, downtown Brooklyn, USA. On the program today, Donald Trump as Silvio Berlusconi. What can we learn from that former fascist authoritarian? With assistant professor at the New School in the philosophy department, Cinzia Arruzza. Also on the program today, lawsuits in Wisconsin and Pennsylvania brought by the Green Party to continue and expand a recount in those three states. An elector resigned in the name of God, to absolutely no effect. Meanwhile, the fight for the DNC chair continues as Ellison smeared the president elector, Mr. Donald Trump, lies and threatens those who would claim he lost the popular vote and or would burn the American flag. 75 die in a Colombian plane crash en route to Medellin. And Texas, just days away from requiring the burials of fetuses. North Dakota governor attempts an early evacuation of protesters, and the president electoral, Mr. Trump, appoints an Affordable Care Act hater his Health and Human Services Secretary with a full blueprint on how to repeal health insurance for millions of people. North Carolina Governor Pat McCrory's dream is nearly finally dead. He won't be able to steal this election, bully his way back into the governor's office. And the art of the emolument. Donald Trump's conflict of interest on day one, the most easy and ripe one, is a hotel in Washington, D.C. We will get to all of that and more. Also, just a quick update, if you hadn't heard, there was a driver and a knife attack at Ohio State yesterday. He mowed down a bunch of people, nearly a dozen injured. Fortunately, the vast majority of them not seriously. He ran around with a knife and then was shot by a campus police officer, who I believe is... their campus police are not, you know, they're armed. I don't know if that's the case with all campus police, but in a school that big. And he was shot dead. It's not totally clear what his motivation was, but there was a Facebook post which suggested that he saw himself as a lone wolf terrorist. He was a Somali a kid who was brought over here in 2014. His parents and he were refugees. Had done quite well at school, apparently, but something snapped. But we will update you as we get more information. And thank God it was not that it was a knife and not a gun. I mean, really, you know, this was the same argument that we had with the shooting in Florida at the Pulse nightclub. You know, the bottom line is we can't stop individuals of who are on a spectrum or one end of a spectrum of psychological disorder or who feel disaffected in our society from popping off one day because they've watched a video that they think gives their lives meaning, whether it's, you know, they think they're Bane from Batman or they're part of some global fight for justice to protect people that this country's foreign policy is clearly attacked. There's not much we can do about that. But if we can make it harder for them to have access to weapons, then maybe only one-third of those attacks are going to take people's lives. And that's going to make a difference, obviously, to those people who had family. Because if that guy had a semi-automatic rifle, there would be a dozen people dead, maybe more. Right? I mean, just slam dunk. There's no question about that. So put that in your bee. Put that in your bonnet. And let it be, as it were. Went back to Worcester for Thanksgiving. I'll talk more about my... Well, I don't know if I will talk more about Thanksgiving. I might, actually, in the fun half. Got a little heated. But my grandmother has since passed away. She passed away 3 years ago, right? Like literally a week or two after Saul was born. Every time I would go home for Thanksgiving... Well, let me tell you how... Let me do it this way. This is how I ended up thinking about Harry's when I went to Thanksgiving. Because whenever I saw my grandmother, she would always complain that I was unshaven. Always. Because I always was. Then I got a little bit older. I got matured a little bit. But if I ever had time off, I wouldn't shave. So this is the first Thanksgiving I went to shaven because my grandmother wasn't there. And it was just my way of like, you know, I don't know, saluting my grandmother in some fashion. And I did it with my Harry's razor. So I was literally, I mean, this may be too heavy of a pitch for this, but I was thinking about my grandmother with my Harry's razor. I mean, that's, it's weird. It's weird. But Harry's is a great razor. As now, maybe you'll think of my grandmother when you do. I mean, this could be actually like, this could have been her dream to have like literally hundreds of thousands of people. Not hundreds of thousands. Hundreds or thousands, I should say. Think about her when they're using their Harry razor. Like, Sam should have shaved more to make you happy. This holiday, Harry's is offering a limited edition shaving set. Midnight blue chrome razor handle, which you can get engraved with initials. Three of Harry's German-engineered five-blade cartridges that provide a close, comfortable shave. Foaming shave cream that smells amazing. A beautifully designed gift box goes for $30 on harrys.com. They also offer handles and sets just starting at $10 if you haven't already tried Harry's for yourself. Listen, until for the next, I don't know, about a week or so, free shipping ends on December 9th, so act now. Go to harrys.com right now. You get a limited edition holiday shave set while supplies last. And don't forget to enter the code MajorityReport at checkout for $5 off. That's harrys.com, code MajorityReport. $5 off that Harry's gift box. It makes a great gift. I gave one to my dad for Father's Day. And he was pretty impressed. I mean, it's not like he still talks about it. It was 6 months ago. But I don't think he probably even remembers. But he enjoyed it at the time. All right, and this one. I watched a show on CISO last night. It was funny. CISO, S-E-E-S-O, is the new ad-free streaming service brought to you and bringing you original series, hilarious ones, handpicked classics, weeks of stand-up special, and more. Every episode of SNL is on there the day after they air. The Tonight Show with Fallon and Late Night with Seth Meyers the day after they air. They have classics like 30 Rock, Parks and Rec, and Saved by the Bell. And even British comedies, I've mentioned before, my favorite, perhaps one of my favorite all-time series ever, was The Original Office with Ricky Gervais. Not talking about Ricky Gervais' entire arc of his career. I'm talking about The Office. The entire Monty Python catalog. The IT Crowd. Steve Coogan is Alan Partridge. This, I'm actually thinking, like, this is something I should get just for Myla. It's just $3.99 per month. I'm so close to cord cutting, I can't even tell you. All right, so last night, I watched Jonah Ray's, I don't know what it's called, this travel show, Hidden America. Now, to be fair, it was about Boston. So I particularly enjoyed it. But he does, it's like a travel show, but all the people that he's talking to there are fake. And it was genuinely funny. And he throws away a lot of good stuff. There was one thing he said about Boston. It was like, while I was in Boston, I met a diverse group of people who are many different shades of white. It was funny. It was a funny show. You know what? It's worth it just for that. But check out Hidden America with Jonah Ray if you've got CISO. And if you don't have CISO, go get it. My listeners can try CISO for free for 2 months. For 2 months! Use the promo code MAJORITY at checkout. Promo code MAJORITY, CISO, S-E-E-S-O. You can't get these shows anywhere else. And the ones that you can't get anywhere else, you can get them here. CISO.com right now. Sign up 2 months free with the promo code MAJORITY at checkout. That's CISO.com, promo code MAJORITY. All right, we're going to take a quick break. When we come back, we'll be talking to Cinzia Arruzza. She is an assistant professor at New School in philosophy and talking about the dangers of anti-Trumpism. We'll be right back after this. We are back. Sam Cedar on the Majority Report on the phone. It is a pleasure to welcome to the program Cinzia Arruzza. She is a professor of philosophy at the New School and writing in the Jacobin, The Dangers of Anti-Trumpism. Silvio Berlusconi's tenure as Italian prime minister shows how not to resist an authoritarian demagogue. Welcome to the program, Cinzia.
Thank you.
So your piece... Well, let's. Your piece is, in some respects, a direct response to a piece written by Luigi, and I'm going to destroy his last name, Zingalesnov.
Zingales, yes.
in I did destroy his last name, but in the New York Times. Before we get to your critique of that piece, give us the rundown of Silvio Berlusconi's a compare and contrast, if you will, and then we'll move into that piece and the sort of, I guess, the one sort of false assumption or misinterpretation that it makes, at least at the beginning. But compare and contrast for us, Berlusconi and Trump. Why is Berlusconi so such an appropriate example for us?
Okay, so actually, I think that the analogies and the similarities are most aesthetic in the sense that, Trump, Berlusconi also legitimized a form of political incorrectness as a political discourse. So he used sexist and racist language without any problems. He used to make very gross jokes, and he also had this kind of kitschy aesthetics, so showing off his wealth, and something similar in the form of communication that both Trump and Berlusconi adopted is the fact that they both insisted on their inexperience with the political establishment, so on the fact that they are not part of the old political establishment, but rather come from business, and that their experience and their success as businessmen is actually what qualifies them to lead the country successfully. So there was also this element of anti-establishment propaganda, let's say, that Berlusconi was mobilizing. But there are also very significant differences. First of all, of course, the Italian parliamentary system works in a very different way, because we have a different electoral law and a plurality of parties. And also Berlusconi, when he decided to enter the political scene in 1994, he actually, first of all, built a party, something that Trump didn't do. So he built a new party using the infrastructure of his companies, of his business empire, as the basis for the new national party. And also, Berlusconi had a very different foreign politics in the sense that, like Trump, he was a friend of Putin, but he was also not an isolationist. He didn't challenge, for example, the European Union, at least not until 2011. And finally, the final analogy, of course, has to do with the fact that both of them, of course, mobilize a form of right-wing populist and authoritarian discourse. So this is certainly similar between the two of them. But I'm suspicious about making predictions about what Trump will actually do based on Berlusconi's experience, because, again, the differences are relevant.
Right. I mean, in terms of... So as you've laid out, there are some aesthetic similarities. In terms of like a political agenda, I guess that remains to be seen, but there's clearly, give me your sense. I mean, you've touched on this, but, and I'm becoming, more and more convinced that, there's a huge authoritarian element, not just in those individuals, or at least within Trump and perhaps Berlusconi, but also in the people who were attracted to voting for those individuals. I mean, where along that spectrum would you put Berlusconi and Trump in terms of just that almost quasi-psychological character?
Yeah, so I think that... Like in the case of Trump voters, I think there is an heterogeneity, a variety of motivations that push people to vote for them. And of course, there is part of the voters that are actually attracted by the figure of the strong man who can fix things, basically, who can arrive and find the solution. And by the way, like Trump, actually Berlusconi did ally with the neo-fascist right. So in other his government in 1994 was the first government in the history of the Italian Republic where a neo-fascist party, so the evolution of a neo-fascist party took part in the government. So he was also responsible for basically allowing, legitimizing the presence of neo-fascists in government. So clearly there is there was this element and this this idea that the successful and also this sort of maybe of phantasmatic identification in the successful businessman who could have who can have as many women as he wishes and so on. So this did play a role, but I think there were also other factors that played a significant role in the vote for Berlusconi, as they play a significant vote in the role in the vote for Trump.
Yes, and let's get to that, and that's part of the critique that you're making with Luigi
Zingales,
a piece in the New York Times. Now, I have to say that, like, I think in his piece, he's saying two different things that are not. There seems to be a little bit of a sleight of hand that goes on here. It seems to me. In his piece, I mean, on one hand, they're talking about he's talking about two different things. The one is the idea that you shouldn't focus, or at least in terms of Berlusconi, the failure of his opponents was to focus so much on his character, and
yes.
But then there's also seems to be in Luigi's piece a, if you're not focusing on his character, then you actually should accept part of the policies. I mean, break it down for us what your critique is. I mean, because there is there's a little bit of a sleight of hand there that I thought was interesting, yes. And you brought that out in your critique.
So the his hypothesis in his reconstruction of what happened in Italy with Berlusconi is that the reason for Berlusconi's power and strength was the fact that he was constantly attacked for his character flaws, so his misogyny, his scandals, also his corruption, his conflict of interest. And this demonization basically contributed to actually strengthen him. And also that there was a prejudicial opposition to everything that Berlusconi did. Now, I would agree with him about the fact that the insistence on the propaganda on his character didn't really work. So it didn't convince voters not to vote for him. But the idea that there was a prejudicial opposition to Berlusconi in the parliament, because this is how Zingales concludes, that Democrats in the Congress should now precisely try to cooperate with Trump. But the problem with this is that actually the center-left parties in Italy did cooperate with Berlusconi. They even tried to pass a constitutional reform with Berlusconi. So it is a bit bizarre to think that the problem was the prejudicial opposition to Berlusconi in Parliament. I think the reasons for Berlusconi's power lie absolutely elsewhere, certainly not in the unwillingness of the center-left to cooperate with him on some policies. Actually, probably the contrary is true. The compromises made by the center-left with Berlusconi actually helped Berlusconi. For example, the fact that the center-left refused to pass a law on the conflict of interest. So in other words, they didn't do anything to actually undermine the monopoly of the media that Berlusconi had. So in this sense, actually, they somehow protected him. So I was a bit surprised by this reconstruction by Zingales.
Yeah, I was struck by it too. I mean, it's a little bit confusing. It is one thing, and I agree with the. It seems a very reasonable critique, particularly after the failure of the Clinton campaign, which it seems to me and never criticized Donald Trump on policy at any point. It was always about fitness for office. His misogyny, his racism, his xenophobia, all of which I think deserved critique. But there was never, and it seems to have been a strategy, never an attempt to critique him on policy. So as, and certainly Clinton had a, what I think still was a, for a Democratic presidential candidate anyways, a very progressive platform. However, she did not run on that in the general election. I mean, I don't think there's any dispute about that. That's not what they emphasized at any point. That's not what she was talking about at any point in any meaningful way, and certainly not critiquing him. But that's not what Luigi is saying here. He's sort of taking another step by saying, like, oh, and then if you do have a policy critique, you should sort of cave on it.
Is that exactly. Yeah, exactly. And by the way, so the problem is quite similar to what happened in Italy, contrary to what Zingales said, in the sense that precisely center-left forces in Italy, for over the course of the years, they constantly attacked Berlusconi on his character, but they didn't really break with Berlusconi concerning actual policies, particularly issues that had to do with constitutional reform which had to do with the reform of the public education system. So on the one hand, yes, they were criticizing him, but on the other hand, there was also an element of continuity between Berlusconi's policies and center-left policies. And this was the major problem, that they were really not so entitled to criticize his austerity and neoliberal policies, because they were the first ones who were carrying them on. So this was, I think, actually the main problem in the form of anti-Berlusconism took in Italy. So it was a constant insistence on Berlusconi's fascism, the danger for democracy, his ridiculous character, the fact he was a buffoon, that we were ashamed of him at the international meetings and so on, but without ever really suggesting or putting forward an alternative project on policies that had to do with the concrete life of Italian people and of migrants in Italy. So I think this was the real weakness.
Now, I have only a passing familiarity with Italian form of government, but there was a period in the first government that Berlusconi had put together, which to maintain the premiership, I guess, one needs to have a coalition, and
yes,
that coalition can fall apart at any time. I mean, unlike the falling apart of that coalition could have near immediate impact on whether or not you retain your position. So in 1994, Berlusconi alienates Americans call the Northern League, which is basically just the party from the North. And then there's also a general strike. Just give us a sense of that. Like, how did that... Go ahead.
So this is something that is usually forgotten, because in the imagination of anti-Berlusconi, mainstream anti-Berlusconism in Italy, Berlusconi ruled Italy for 20 years. Of course, this is not true, in the sense that in 1994, his government lasted only 7-8 months. And the reason for the fall of the government was that one of the parties in the coalition, the Northern League, decided to withdraw its support. This support was necessary because the prime minister is not directly elected in Italy, so he needs to have a majority in the parliament in order to go on being prime minister. So the reason why the Northern League decided to withdraw its support had to do with two main factors. One was the Berlusconi's attempt to reform the pension system, and to cut pensions, which the Northern League rejected, because part of the Northern League electorate was actually working class in the north of Italy. And then the second problem was that Berlusconi was not really acting on federalism, and the Northern League is a federalist party. And in addition to this, what caused to the crisis of the first government was precisely the fact that the main unions organized a general strike against the reform of the pension system and two huge mobilizations, one of which was an enormous demonstration in Rome, in which around 1 million people participated. So this basically forced Berlusconi to resign. And what is interesting is the fact that in order to understand why then Berlusconi came back to power is the fact that after Berlusconi's government, there was a technocratic government which did pass the reform of the pension system with the support of the center-left and with the agreement of the unions, and then 5 more years of the center-left government, which actually carried out on a series of austerity policies. For example, a major reform of the labor law, which introduced for the first time in Italy the casualization of labor, as well as an enormous mass of privatization of public companies and assets, a reform, an attempted reform of the educational system, and a partial reform of the educational system in direction of a corporate style management of public schools and universities. And also they even passed an anti-immigrant law. So it was the center-left which introduced in Italy for the first time detention centers for immigrants, something that is usually forgotten, again, by mainstream anti-Berlusconism. So in order to explain why Berlusconi then came back to power, which much more forced than earlier in 2001, one has to take into account what happened in these 6 years of basically center-left government.
Well, I mean, in many respects, it sounds like the center-left party did was to give Berlusconi, but without Berlusconi. I mean,
exactly. And this was an increase. Of course, you know, Berlusconi made some of the laws passed by the center-left worse, for example, the immigration law. But, you know, Berlusconi's government immigration law is just an amendment of the previous law, so which shows the continuity between anti-immigration policies of the center-left and of Berlusconi. And we have now the paradox that the current government, Renzi's government, has actually been praised by Berlusconi. In the sense, Berlusconi recently declared that Renzi is the only real political leader comparable to him in Italy. And the reason for this is precisely that the policies that Renzi is now carry on are actually pretty much in continuity with the Berlusconi's government. They are, for example, Renzi managed something that Berlusconi didn't manage to do. Renzi managed to pass yet another reform of the labor law, which really introduces even more casualization of labor and actually eliminates a set of labor rights that were that had been conquered during the 70s by the Italian working class. So. We have now precisely a government that is basically passing the same measures, if not worse, but without the kind of aesthetics that government.
Okay, so I think people are probably vaguely aware that there's going to be a major referendum in Italy in very soon, actually. To determine a slate of reforms that Renzi has proposed. It looks like it may be in trouble. And without getting into to that aspect, because what interests me is did the left become unmoored from its policy agenda because it spent too much time focusing on the character and just the horribleness of the man as opposed to the horribleness of the program?
No, I think we should distinguish between two aspects. the center left in the parliament, so the organized forces, decided to implement neoliberal and austerity policies not because of Berlusconi, but because they sincerely believed that this was what was needed for the modernization of the country. In this sense, the center-left forces in Italy, paradoxically, are actually even more than Berlusconi, satisfying, let's say, the interest of Europeanist capital in Italy. The voters are in the majority, voters who had voted the Communist Party for years. In any case, they are left-leaning and so on. And in their case, yes, I think that this form of anti-Berlusconism did play a very negative role, in the sense that center-left voters focused so much on the danger of Berlusconism, on the necessity of preventing the return of Berlusconi to power at all costs and so on, that basically they accepted this neoliberal turn from their parties. They kept voting for these parties. They didn't protest. They didn't participate in large mobilizations against the austerity measures of this party. So, in this sense, then the anti-Berlusconism did play a very negative role in the sense of shifting the focus from what was actually happening in terms of transformation of the country and elimination of a series of social rights, a true obsession with Berlusconi's character, Berlusconi's jokes, Berlusconi's harem, and so on. I think this did play a very negative role.
All right, and so let's move to the lessons that you take from that era in Italy, and it is what it is that well, you tell us.
Okay. So, of course, the situation is complicated and there are major differences, again, because the political system is quite different. But what I would suggest is that the first thing that one should avoid is precisely to transform Trump into some sort of demon that one has to keep away from the government at all cost. Not because, contrary to Zingales, I'm not saying this because I'm suggesting that we should not oppose Trump. On the contrary, I think that it is absolutely urgent to create social coalitions, large social coalitions, possibly on a national level, on various issues. For example, in defense of migrants, in defense of the healthcare with all its limitations system. So I think this has to be done, but with the idea that we are not in a situation in which everything is better than Trump, in the sense that then we have to accept every kind of neoliberal policy, provided that we can get rid of Trump. Because this I think is a recipe for disaster. In other words, just to use a slogan, I think that lesser evilism has actually produced the worst in Italy, and I'm afraid that it could produce the worst in the States too. In other words, lesser evilism doesn't address the causes for Trump's success, but actually makes them worse, and therefore creates the conditions for actually strengthening of Trump's power. So I think that having building social movements, social coalitions, autonomous from the Democratic Party, and very clear about the defense of social rights and the defense of liberties and anti-racist politics, anti-sexist politics. I think this is what we should do in the next period.
So, I mean, in other words, if we're looking at, let's say, this infrastructure bill, for example, right? I mean, because we don't have the same opportunity, he's going to be, I mean, unless something irregular happens, he's going to be the president for the next 4 years, no matter what. But so the real question becomes, how is he fought on grounds like, let's say, for instance, the infrastructure bill, which is going to be the first thing. I mean, I think, like, it's clear, it seems to me, that when it comes to getting rid of the Affordable Care Act and with what they're talking about, at least what the plan of the new Health Human Services appointee is, or nominee, I should say, at this point, getting rid of Medicaid expansion. I mean, that's, you know, these are sort of no-brainers here, right? I mean, it's you're going to fight those.
Yeah.
But when it's something like the infrastructure bill, where there are some things in it that appeal to those of us left of center, we've got to be careful about subscribing to it. Because is it because it's Trump's, or is it because it happens to be a huge privatization scheme, or both?
Of course, I mean, one should see the content of the bill. I'm very suspicious that it's going to be a good bill. But
right. Let's assume it looks like his plan. Okay, let's assume, just for the sake of argument, so that we have some sort of like tangible markers here, that it is a huge privatization scheme where we provide loans to private entities to build things that they can monetize. And we give them the rights to monetize it. So it would all go towards, you know, the most trafficked roads, and it would just be owned by a private entity, and they could collect the tolls for it, and we would give them the loan to build it. Let's just assume that's what it is, because that's basically the outlines that we see from his plan. If it's something like that, do we oppose it because it's Trump? Do we oppose it because of the nature of the bill? If Trump came out with, like, we're just going to borrow money, and we're going to build things, and it's going to be public. It's going to be the greatest expansion, genuine expansion of public infrastructure in 60 years. Do we go along with that? Give us a sense of that.
What you're representing is actually not really a public infrastructure, because it would be managed by the private sector anyway. With the system of tolls and so on. So already this, this is an element of criticism. If we want to build a public infrastructure, then let's build a real public infrastructure that is not based on profit making. Because clearly, private companies will need to make a profit on this. And this will increase the tolls, and it will actually affect people. But besides this, so here is the issue I'm afraid that the idea that, you know, of supporting of a large project of infrastructure building because it creates jobs and so on, it would be an attempt to appeal to the white working class that felt abandoned by the Democratic Party, especially by Clinton, that didn't feel represented and so on. Now, the cost of doing this, however, would be that of legitimizing and accepting a government that is going to have an incredibly bad politics concerning migrants, concerning racialized people, concerning women and so on. So, who are also the people who will probably be willing to mobilize in the next months against Trump and on issues that have to do with the defense of social rights and liberties and so on. So, honestly, I would really, I mean, if we are talking about, for example, Sanders or the left around Sanders and so on, I would be very careful about creating, let's say, a distance between the decisions that are made in the Congress and the sincere and legitimate worries of racialized people, LGBT people, women, and a sector of the working class that is honestly worried about what Trump may do. So, in other words, is it worth doing this? Is this really the way in which we should proceed, or rather, should we not try to really raise the issue that we need a radical alternative altogether in the States today, a radical alternative that keeps together investments for the creation of jobs, for infrastructure and so on, but also an anti-racist, anti-sexist right. politics, and doesn't force us to make a choice between the two. So this would be my position. Another thing, by the way, I think another thing that would be necessary to do is really to have a campaign on the electoral system, because I think these elections are really showing the absurdity and irrationality of the electoral system. So, because de facto a minority of the voters have voted for Trump, and I think this campaign would have also the sense of raising the issue that there is a legitimate demand for radical change that is taking place in the States that cannot find a real equal or a real representation in the two main parties, in the Republican and in the Democratic Party. And this is an issue that has to do with democracy, but it has to do with the future of the country. And I would say that we should really work on a political project that actually opens up a space for alternative voices, so that opens up a space against this cage of the two-party system.
Well, Cinzia Arruzza, the piece is The Dangers of Anti-Trumpism in the Jacobin, professor at the New School of Philosophy. Thank you so much for your time today. I really appreciate it.
Thank you. Have a nice day.
You too. Bye-bye. All right, folks. We're going to be doing a little more of this. I figure, you know, we're going to start with the bigger pictures over the next week or two in terms of our interviews. And, you know, we'll get also a little bit granular. But, I mean, that's where we're going to start. And dealing with the authoritarian quality. You know, years ago, and I think, gosh, you know what? I meant to look this up. I think the early on, like the early days of this show, of this iteration, I should say, of the Majority Report, I feel like probably 6 years ago, from now, almost directly now, we had, I feel like maybe we had a guy named Jonathan Weiler on. And I may be totally making all of this up and not, I may not be accurate about any of this. And if there is a person named Jonathan Weiler and he wasn't on, no, he was on. Actually, now I'm looking at it. It's Monday, November 15th. So it was a little bit more than 6 years ago. He had a book on authoritarianism. We had him on the show. This is like our soft launch. That was the day after I did that episode on today's show. Sam gets mad at Jon Stewart. That's the way that we pitched that show. Have not necessarily, although that's probably a good title, isn't it? That's probably like a good,
it's clickable.
Totally clickable. Dorsey. Totally on the ball back then.
It's incredibly on brand.
No wonder why that dude got all the listicle work at BuzzFeed for a while. Anyways.
Sam so, gets mad at can just be a segment. Sam gets mad at blank.
I think we're going to do a lot more segments. I mean, I always say that, and we never do. But so Jonathan Weiler was on. But at the time, and back during the aughts, I had been reading stuff by this guy named Bob Altemeyer, and I'm going to try and have him on. So I just started re-listening to his audiobook. And I want to talk to him about maybe like releasing it as a podcast. I don't know if it's released as a podcast anywhere. But the more you hear his research, he's a psychiatrist, or psychologist, not a political scientist. And the more you hear about, more I should say, the more I hear and read about authoritarianism as it plays out in the authoritarian followers, right? I mean, there's the authoritarians who are the leaders, but there's a lot more authoritarians who are followers, obviously. The psychological makeup is so one-to-one with what we're seeing with Trump. And I would also argue probably the best explanation of how he got the votes he got. I mean, obviously, there's a dozen factors, right? And it's almost impossible to disaggregate these things. And then there is a set of things that don't necessarily measure up one-to-one why people voted for Trump that might be good ways of prying him from his voters or bringing out more voters on the Democratic side. I mean, it is the case that Trump got about a million more votes than Mitt Romney and got them in areas where he hadn't got them before. Some of the red states went more red, but obviously there was a couple of swing states that we know about where he picked up a couple extra votes as well, much to the detriment of the country and to Hillary Clinton's aspirations for the presidency. But when you start to hear these experiments on the authoritarians as to what gets them going, you start to understand like why you may have those voters, those low propensity voters come out for a Donald Trump when they wouldn't come out for a Mitt Romney or against a Barack Obama. Remember, for every one voter that switched from Obama to Trump, there were five that hadn't voted in 2012, came out to vote for Trump. And those five, like, what went off in their brains that said, I should vote for this guy? You know, the economic situation of people is a backdrop, but it's not, look, you know, Trump's voters, his strength was not with necessarily poor people. And I think there was a lot of his rhetoric and his demeanor and his just who he is that triggered some of these sort of like psychological impulses in authoritarians who are like, okay, yeah, it's one thing to vote against a black guy, but it's another thing to vote against the guy who's just going to come in and clean it all up. Those were all voters. Those voters who didn't vote, who came out to vote for Trump, were sitting around on their podcast saying, like, this whole lesser of two evilism, I'm not going to do it. Romney's horrible and Trump's horrible. I mean, Obama's horrible. I don't care how much I don't like black people. I'm not going to vote for either one of them. But Trump, he's going to do something, man. So we're going to dig into that over the coming weeks. And then also in the fun half today, I am going to outline, or maybe we'll do this tomorrow, how the Affordable Care Act is going to get destroyed. Not just the process, but also in what way. And it's going to be really bad. It's going to be particularly bad if you are older. It's going to be particularly bad. I mean, this is if you rely on Obamacare in some fashion. Now, if you rely on Medicaid, you're in deep trouble. If you are older and rely on insurance that you've gotten in the exchange, it's going to be a problem. Broadly speaking, it's going to be tougher for you when you're older because there's some regulations that are going to roll back. Pre-existing conditions could be problematic if you ever lose your insurance. We'll go through all of it. I mean, and the reason why we can do that with such specificity. Did I say that word right?
Specificity.
Thank you. It sounded wrong when it came out of my mouth. So sitting there, my, you know, my kid says Paschetti and all this, and then you start saying it, and all of a sudden you're like, wait, what is it again? What's, how does the word go right? The reason why we have such particulars, the reason why we can get so granular with how the Affordable Care Act will be replaced is because of who Donald Trump has nominated to be the Secretary of Health and Human Services. This guy, Tom Price, who was literally the only person who had, he's a congressman from Georgia. He's from Georgia and he sits on the House Budget Committee, chairman. And he has a 242-page proposal for gutting the Affordable Care Act. The most specific proposal of anybody out there. And so they got a game plan. And it's going to end up maybe being a negotiation between him and Paul Ryan. So we'll go through that tomorrow. That's what we're going to do tomorrow. When we go into the fun half, we've got all sorts of fun things. Alex Jones mocking Matt Taibbi. Should get Taibbi to call in. Somebody have Taibbi call into the program. Stephen Moore, you know that hack from Heritage Foundation, Stephen Moore? He's one of the seven Steves, I guess, who made up the economic policy team. It's unbelievable. I mean, I guess it's not that unbelievable, but they have given away like every single principle they have to make money with Trump. It's fascinating. Yeah, libertarianism, conservative idea. We don't need to necessarily. Let me check my bank account and see how much I can afford to. Oh, no, forget it. We'll go on and on. We got a lot of a sound to play. Folks, it's your membership that makes this show possible. We're going to be here for the next 4 years, unless they take us away or shut us down by lawsuits or net neutrality or firebomb us.
What?
I'm just saying. And you can help us grow and deal with this situation. We're, you know, still, in my mind, still trying to figure out, like, you know, what tact are we going to take? I don't want to spend all our time on this program talking about how, you know, disgusting Donald Trump is, how orangey is. We'll spend a decent amount of time with that. We'll, you know, do some of that in the fun half. But
that stuff's secondary.
I mean, the idea is, one is, how do you oppose him? How do you oppose, more importantly, it seems to me, the policies, right? And that means opposing the Republican Senate and House and the Republican-controlled Supreme Court. And then also ask, how do you keep alive ideas to implement when everybody knows that nobody, we're not going to implement these ideas for at least 4 years. Best case scenario, right? I mean, I think I mentioned this in the show that we played on Friday, that I wanted that interview with Les Leopold because he mentioned Bill Lozanik, one of my favorite guests over the past 5 years, who came in with the, you know, the stories of the stock buybacks and the stock options as compensation for CEOs and capital gains, and how that sort of those three elements basically created these cottage industries within actual businesses. And, you know, if the SEC was to go back to the pre-1980 Reagan change in the rule where companies could buy their own stocks back as a way of manipulating the prices, we were to reverse that, that would create a cascading effect on the decisions, outsourcing, I mean, everything. But you also realize, like, hey, you know, and I'm talking to him, and I'm realizing, like, hey, you know, in 6 months, there may not be an SEC. I mean, there'll be a place. There'll be an office. People will go there. It'll probably be like a cafe. People just go and hang out, have coffee. Just watch. Watch big screen TVs of like, there are things happening with the stock market. And then occasionally, you know, Trump gives a call down there. I don't like this company, so do something to it. That Hilton. Yeah. Something like that. So I don't know. But it's important so that in 4 years, 8 years, 10, 12 years, whenever it is, when I'm an old, old man and Saul or Mila's doing the show and some of these youngins are set to take office, like that idea will still be kicking around. They won't have to go like, I think if we go back 15 years in the archives of all these things, these ideas will still be around.
Mila could do the show like now. It'd be fine.
Maybe. Maybe.
Not that I want you to do the show, but maybe.
Mila Mondays.
Well, that was a little bit.
you know, maybe someone should tell Mike about Wally Pipp. Who's Wally Pipp? Look him up. Maybe Michael should, because Mila Mondays keeps the alliteration alive.
Wally Pipp, the 1913 baseball player?
That's right.
What's your deal?
Read the story about Wally Pipp. I can wait.
Right now?
Oh, he lost his job to Lou Gehrig?
That's right. He was sick or he had a boo-boo. And he sat down for one day. Lou Gehrig took his job and boom. Last time Wally Pipp played.
Oh, my God.
All right, folks. To become a member of this program, go to jointhemajorityreport.com. JustCoffee.coop. Fair trade coffee, tea, or chocolate. Use the coupon code MAJORITY. Get 10% off. Ladies and gentlemen, we are days away from announcing a legitimate gifting program for a Majority Report membership. We're days away from announcing it. Days away. Where you will be able to get a gift of the Majority Report membership to give to somebody. So forget what you're doing in terms of like Christmas gifts and Hanukkah gifts, Kwanzaa gifts, any gifts. Don't cancel that. They don't want those things. What they want is a
birthday gifts.
Birthday gifts.
That you birthdays New you Year's keep secret gifts from your coworkers or whoever.
Whatever.
Whomever.
Give them a thing to Majority Report. All right. So and of course if you buy crap from Amazon or Jet.com, do so through our link at majorityreportkickback.com. Be right back with a fun half.
Sit in a blue.